Hey, so as he said, I'm Naren, and I work as a software consultant for a startup called Tarka Labs. So Tarka Labs is a tech agnostic consulting company, and apart from coding, or if I'm not coding, I'll be either cycling, traveling, or I'll occasionally blog about productivity and software. So, past 5 years, I've been working on different technologies and mostly into backend architecture design, DevOps, and that's my Twitter handle, and that's my blog. So, yeah. Also, I have pasted my Twitter handle in all these slides. If you have any questions, you can just tweet it to me. You can see it right over here. And today's agenda is we'll first talk about the basics of concurrency, or not even concurrency, even before that, synchronous, asynchronous process and parallelism. And next we'll take a look at some real world examples, and we'll get started with asyncIO and what are the concepts behind asyncIO and the tooling it provides. And we'll have a duel between concurrency and parallelism, which means we'll try to hit the game servers, some like 500 to 1000 requests using a concurrent code as well as a parallel code, and try to benchmark it. And we'll also see how asyncIO is different from multithreading. And at the end of the talk, we'll see the disadvantages of concurrency. There'll be some caveats for every tech we use. So, and yes, before I start, how many of you have attended the last talk yesterday on concurrency? It's from, okay. So yeah, so I might be repeating the examples because, you know, that's the real world example. That's how the real world works concurrently. And of course, you guys have no choice because I have the mic, I have to sit through it. And so yeah, we'll get started. So before understanding concurrency, we need to understand what's sync and async process. So what's synchronous execution is when there are two tasks. So when the control flow will be executing the first task, and you take the first task as requesting something to the other process or other server, and it'll be waiting for the response. So it's a blocking call. So until it gets the response from the external server, or it might be a database or anything, so it will be waiting, and the control flow will be blocked. And only after it receives the response, it continues to execute the program. And while in asynchronous, so whenever there is a blocking call or IO involved, so it calls the respective process, and the control flow comes back, and it continues execution. So when it gets a response, it will pick it up on the fly. So there is, it's non-blocking. It won't wait for the response. That's asynchronous. And about concurrent and concurrency and parallelism. So what parallelism is, it's just throwing your tasks to your resources, which means CPU cores, and executing each task in their own cores. It's yeah, as I said, if there are two tasks, task one will be executed first, and when there is a blocking call in task one, it will start executing task two for some time, and when it encounters a blocking call in task two, it will come back to task one, and it will be like switching often based on the blocking calls in each tasks. So when I mean a blocking call, mostly it's IO, file IO, or a HTTP call, or a request to a database. Who's this?
You're saying
yes, it was fastest man, I guess. And so if you take Olympic track, at a time only like 8 to 9 runners or athletes can run in that. They are running parallelly, but it doesn't mean that only 8 people will be participating in an Olympic event. So imagine these athletes as the tasks and the tracks as your resources, CPU cores, whereas the other tasks, which are the athletes, will be waiting in the queue. Well, these athletes will be using the tracks. So the race coordinator will be assigning the numbers to the athletes, or they'll be assigning the tracks to the respective athletes. So you can imagine the race coordinator as your task scheduler. So the race coordinator picks up the tasks from the queue, which are the athletes, and assign the tracks to them so that they can perform. So while the athletes are waiting, mostly they won't be idle. They'll be trying to relax or stretch their muscles or something. So, and yeah, that's how the concurrency works. And quick recap, we saw what's synchronous, asynchronous, and what's concurrency, as well as parallelism. So it's blocking operations, or synchronous or blocking operations. Async means it's non-blocking. Concurrency is making progress together, but parallelism is literally making progress parallel in different resources. And we'll also see a real-world example to learn how concurrency is not parallelism. I hope everyone had their breakfast. So yeah, it's noodles. So can anyone tell me which restaurant serves best noodles in around this city or town? Any restaurants? You don't know? Okay. So let's take the best restaurant in town. The restaurant owner comes to you and say that, hey, can you just open up a franchisee for me? And he gives you all the funding. And you start small with a single waiter and a single chef. So then a customer appears from nowhere, and you serve them. So it's a single customer comes, and you have your resources. You have one waiter and one chef, and you'll be able to serve the customer whatever he asks, and happy customer. And the next, that customer goes and spreads the word that, hey, we got some good food over here, let's go and check it out. Now you have three customers at the same time. And now what happens? You'll be able to serve them, but not as efficient as the previous one, because right now we have three customers at the same time and with a different menus. So you think, okay, we are not able to make the customers happy, and we have to scale up. And you put in more resources, like you put in more waiters so that they can attend the customers. But there, the lonely panda, which is the chef, is getting all the pressure. He has to cook all the meals. So you are again throwing resources by increasing your number of chefs in the kitchen. So now for three customers at any given time, you are able to happily serve them, and you make them, end of the day, customers are happy. Now your restaurant becomes very famous, and almost most of them in the town comes to your restaurant for a weekend, or they come with a large group. So what do you think again? So okay, we are getting like at least 10 plus customers at any given time. We should be throwing in more resources to serve them. So will this work? Not really. Yeah. Why? Because you can't just simply throw resources at the problem and try to solve it. So there are other ways to solve it. And if you take this, so in your kitchen, if you have like these many chefs, you'll be running out of your resources in kitchen, which means the utensils or your gas. So you also need to scale your kitchen based on the chefs you're throwing in. So how you, that's why restaurants operates concurrently, not parallelly. So this is what they do. They have two or three waiters, and they have two chefs in their kitchen, and they maintain a queue for their customers. So the waiter picks up a menu and put it in that queue, and when chefs are preparing orders for other customers, it'll be the meal will be waiting in the request will be waiting in the queue, and once a meal is prepared by a chef, he'll be picking up other requests from the queue. So this is how the concurrent model works. And we'll jump into concurrency in Python 3. So how many of them have used concurrency or asyncIO in Python? Yes, nice. So anyhow, we'll look at some basics of asyncIO in Python 3. So it's a standard library in Python 3. It's single threaded, and it was introduced in Python 3.4. And it's heavily inspired from a library called Twisted. So it's been there since Python 2.7. And yeah, Twisted has been there from Python 2.7, and asyncIO was built for Python 3.4. And these are the three main concepts in asyncIO. So event loops, coroutines, and futures. So what event loop is, it's like a manager. Remember I talked about the race coordinator in the Olympic track, right? So event loop is similar to that. It manages and distributes the execution of different tasks. And it also responsible for registering the tasks, and it will distribute the control flow. It will like take the control flow back and distribute, give it to other tasks if there is a blocking call. So that's what event loop does. And coroutines are nothing but just the functions, plain functions in Python, but they have like the special thing about these functions is they can release the control flow back to the event loop. So which means if there is a blocking call in that function, the function will be releasing the control flow back to the event loop, and the event loop will be giving back the control flow to that function to execute the task, other task. So you can assume it's similar to Python generators, and a coroutine is scheduled using a event loop. Futures. Futures are like the type of the task you feed into event loop that gets executed by your Python functions, also known as coroutines. So it's an object that represents the task, and it can be completed or pending or even exceptions. So this is the flow of execution of any concurrent Python code. So what happens first is you will be declaring an event loop, and I think, is it visible from the back? No. I'll explain it. I'm not able to zoom it. So the first, after the thread is, there is the event loop. So event loop will be taking all the tasks from a queue, and the dotted box you're seeing is the execution of a single task. So what happens in task one is, so the event the execution will be happening, and the coroutine will be running when there is a blocking call, which is this conditional block. If it's a IO or a sleep, then the event loop, that coroutine will give back the control flow to the event loop, and it executes the task two. So the same thing happens in task two. But whenever there is no blocking call, it will try to finish the task one. So that's how the control flow works, and let's try to dive deep into concurrency. I'll try to do some live coding. Here comes the dangerous part. Mostly I won't be editing much, so you able to see? Is this visible? Yeah, fine. So this is a very simple program to show how the context switch is happening between two tasks in asyncIO. So first you're as usual importing the asyncIO and you're defining your coroutines. So you can see coroutines are nothing but it's very similar to functions, but you're preparing it with something called async, which makes a normal function into a coroutine. And you print that the task has been started, and you just wait for like 5 seconds. So if you notice here, we are using a keyword called await. What await does is it will just take this control flow and give back to the event loop. And sleep is of course a blocking call. So whenever there's a blocking call, we are using the keyword await and giving back the control flow to the event loop. And also you are not using normal time.sleep because you need special functions which are capable of returning the control flow back to the event loop. So that's why you are using this sleep provided by the asyncIO module. If you are using normal time.sleep, it won't be able to return the control flow and it will be a blocking call. Similarly, you are defining your coroutine 2 and you are printing it started and you are doing a sleep for 5 seconds. Then you are getting the creating the event loop object, creating the event loop instance, and you are creating your converting your tasks to wrapping up the tasks into futures. So as I said, futures are nothing but the objects which represents your tasks. So you're wrapping up and you are putting it into a list which is a queue, and then you say asyncio dot wait, which means that waits for the both coroutines to complete. And you do you feed in your tasks into your IO loop now. So you are feeding the tasks into your event loop in this line. So you say IO loop dot run until complete and your task list. Then you are closing the event loop. Let's see how this runs. So it started. Let me run it again. So when it came to asyncio.sleep, you can see this line is not printed. So it switched back to task 2. So it started task 2 after the context switch. And again, when it encounters a blocking call, it gives back. And the event loop finds out, okay, there is only one task remaining in the queue, which is the task 1. And it switches back to task 1. And this continues, and task 1 gets finished, and there's only task 2, then this is where it left the task 2. It executes the next line, and task 2 get finished. So if I run this again, it starts the task 1, blocking call starts the task 2, again blocking call comes back to task 1, then task 2. I hope this is clear. And similarly, if you add more tasks, you can see how the blocking is happening. So here what happens is as usual you're timing the code using time.time and you're importing asyncIO. So you have the task 1 here and task 2 which is sleeping for 2 seconds and task 3. So when you execute it, task 1 started and it encounters a blocking call, it goes to task 2, encounters a blocking call, goes to task 3. And since it's blocking for more time here, it's able to complete the task 3 first. And then it comes back to task 1 and task 2. And this shows us that if you are executing your code concurrently or using asyncIO, it won't maintain the order. So when you are executing the code sequentially, it will maintain the order. So you should not expect your output to be ordered. And again, here's we are having a synchronous task. We are executing this task synchronously. We are doing a sleep for a random time, and we are executing the same task asynchronously. Here we are using async to make it a coroutine, but here it's just a Python function. And we use await to give back the control flow. You're initializing the synchronous task. You're just putting into a loop for 10 times, and you're similarly initializing the asynchronous task with ensure future. So ensure future is used to create a task from a coroutine. And then you're kicking off your event loop, as well as you're first executing your synchronous tasks and your event loop next. So let's see what happens when you execute this. So synchronous task is being executed. So it's just a for loop printing the numbers, right? So if you see, it's in the ordered fashion when you execute a synchronous task, or you execute in a sequential manner. But when it comes to async, it's not an ordered fashion. It shows us that you can't expect your output from async program to be in a specific order. If you run it again, the order of execution will change in asynchronous. And we'll try to make a HTTP call both synchronously and asynchronously, and we'll see how it happens. I think I need to connect to my, okay, let me connect to my hotspot. So we are executing, we are trying to hit some API, which is and through synchronous HTTP calls and asynchronous HTTP calls. So we are importing our necessary modules. The URL is, this is the URL we are trying to hit, and it's a GET request. And we are trying to hit three times. So we are, this is the function which makes the HTTP call synchronously. We're using normal request.get, and we are passing the headers and print some server info from the headers. The similar function is written in asynchronously. So here what we are doing is we are using aio-http.request instead of using normal request module. We have to use aio-http, so a special tool, so that the normal request module is a blocking call. So we are using aio-http.request, and we are using the await keyword to tell the event loop that take back the control flow, because this is a blocking call. So whenever you request a server, whenever you do a HTTP request to some server, it's a blocking call. So you know that this is going to block the flow here, and you are deliberately use await to get back the control flow. And you're, as usual, passing the headers and closing the response and returning the server info. So we're initializing the synchronous call, looping four times, and you're initializing the asynchronous call. Use asyncIO.wait, then here, yes, you're kicking off the synchronous, and next the asynchronous, by getting the event loop and feeding your tasks into event loop. So what happens when you run this? Hopefully my hotspot is fast enough. So yeah, it's running. So first the synchronous calls happens, and the first request happens. It took 6 seconds. The second request, it's done, it took 4.53 And the third request is done. It took 12 seconds, very bad hotspot or 4G. And if you take the, ignore these warnings, if you take the, yeah, live coding. If you take the asynchronous thing in this line, it took only 3.36 seconds. But when you executed it synchronously, it took total of 22 seconds, which means you are not waiting for the server to respond. So if you notice, this total time is close to the time which is the minimal time in the sequential execution. So that's what happens when you use asynchronous, when you hit some server asynchronously versus synchronously. And let's talk about a simple helper called return when. So what happens here is, what we are doing here is we are trying to find our IP address. So previously we are just hitting the servers with all the tasks, but here we need this both server are going to return only same IP address. So whichever server responds first, we can. That's enough. You can live with that. You don't have to wait for the other server, right? Anyhow, you're going to get the same IP address. So you're having the services and parameters for them. And you're defining your coroutine. So you use await here when you're hitting the server. And you're initiating all this asynchronous task. But when you're just doing asyncIO.await, you add a parameter called return one. So this event loop, or this list of futures, it returns when the first response is recorded. So what happens is the event loop will get the response and, or the control flow back, and then we are closing the event loop. We'll try to run this. So yeah, we've got an error. So what it says, any guesses why this error happened? Especially this line? Or any guesses? No? So if you notice, we closed the event loop when you got the first response. But there was another task in the event loop, and it wasn't executed, and it was in pending state, which means it was waiting for some response. So in order to close the event loop gracefully, you need to use something called cancel feature. This is the same code, but we are checking, before closing the event loop, you are checking what all futures are pending, and you're canceling it so that you know you can gracefully close the event loop without getting errors or exceptions. So now, but we got the first response from some server, and we cancel the second task and close the event loop. So that's cancel feature. And sometimes when you're requesting some server, some information, the server might be down, or it'll take a very long time to respond. So at that time, you need to have some timeout to close the event loop. So if some server is down, your code should not be waiting for a very long time in order to get the response from the server. So what we do is we declare, it's the same code as the previous example, we declare a timeout here, and while declaring our asynchronous coroutine, we do asyncIO.await, and we put up a new parameter called timeout. So it waits for the task to complete for 3 seconds. If it takes more than 3 seconds, it will time out and return back. So if you run this, so both both server took, no, only one server was responding within 3 seconds. It is 1.69 seconds. So if we try to increase the timeout to 10 seconds, I think hopefully both servers should be responding within 10 seconds. Okay. Okay, both server won't be responding because we are returning when the first task is completed. So if we reduce our timeout to 0.1 seconds, which means we are going to wait only for 0.1 seconds for the server to respond, it's timed out. So none of the server in these two services responded within 0.1 second. And where is my, okay, yes. So we'll do concurrency versus parallelism dual and, oops. Yes, it's good. So we'll do concurrency versus parallelism dual and we'll hit the battlefield server 500 times. And we'll do a mini DOS attack, but don't worry, I'm not going to do it from here. I already did that using my broadband in home, and I'll show the screencast. And we are doing the same thing using multiprocessing to make parallel calls. Let's get back to the slides. And here comes the concurrency versus parallelism dual. So first I'm hitting, one more thing I forgot to mention is we are hitting the APAs as well as writing them to some file. The CPU percentage has been like consuming all the cores because we are using multiprocessing and we are throwing out the CPU cores at our tasks. So it took around 13.99 seconds to hit the servers 500 times. And as you have noticed, all the cores were busy. Now we are running the same 500 calls using asyncIO. If you notice, the cores, it's not fully occupied. So there are sometimes there will be a spike because the switching, the context switching, it will consume some CPU cycles. And if you notice the time here, it took around 14 seconds, which is similar to the parallel calls. And yep. So how long have you got? 5 minutes? Okay. So yeah, how asyncIO was different from multi-threading. So if you take threads are also concurrent, threads execute concurrently, similar to async, but system will take care of the switching between the contexts. Whereas in async, you have the fine control by using the keyword await, and you tell the system when to switch the context. And when system is taking care of the switch can happen anytime, but you have the fine control and you know when to switch, and you don't need logs. So when system is switching, you need some logs on your critical data structures in order to avoid the race conditions. And the cost of task switches in threads, the context switch which we saw, it's costly because threads, they don't use generators. They have to call the function, initialize and call the function every time we switch the context. So it consumes more CPU cycle. And if you take the async, the task switching is very low. So your generator will be already mapped with all your functions in your module, and you're just restarting your generator. So of course, every thing has its own caveats. When you're implementing your code and using async, you need to have special tools. So we saw we weren't able to use normal request module because it didn't support the context switch. So we used AAO HTTP. Or similarly, if you're using some other database drivers, you can't use normal SQL Alchemy or some driver. You need something else. There are many other libraries which will be in par with async library. And there is a learning curve. There are many concepts here, like you have to get to know futures and event loops, and there are many helpers. So you need to, there is a learning curve when you get started with async. And of course, the other disadvantage is, it's not a disadvantage, it's a fact. So Gil, we have GIL, and at any given time, we have only one core doing our work, or a single thread doing our work, while all other calls remain, you know, idle. You can overcome this by utilizing the resource efficiently, maybe by deploying your code using containers. You can deploy multiple containers in a single server so that it will be using all your CPU cores. It's a summary. So we saw about the basics, and we saw what's asyncIO and event loops, coroutines, features, and these are the helper toolings we saw. And references. I should go read this really good article on HackerNoon. Most of the examples were inspired from this article. I mean, copied. So, and I took few pictures from this article for reference, free code camp article. Thank you. So that's it from me. You can find these slides in my website. Yes.
Okay, due to time, maybe we just open for one question. Anyone have any question? No? All right, I think if there's any question, you can just approach.
Yes.
All right.